Hello everyone, I am BridgeStage and here we are going to discuss the solutions and editorial for Code Forces round 817, which was the Div 4 round held today. I solved all of the problems and we'll be discussing the solutions to all of the problems. The round was slightly more difficult than a Div 4 round. E and F had slightly larger implementations, but let's look at all of the problems one by one. So we start with problem A. So we have a name Timur in which T is capital. And any permutation of the word is fine. We have to output yes if we get any permutation of the word. Otherwise, output no. So we could just sort the letters. Whatever the sorting algorithm is used for string sorting, it's lexicographically, it's sorted alphabetically. So we'll just sort both S and T. And if they are permutations of each other, on sorting both of them, we should get the same word. That's just the algorithm that we'll employ. We have a string S which is Timur. So before any of the test, before collecting any of the tests, I just sort the string S, and then for each test case, I consider the particular string T, sort it. Now if S is equal to T, we know that it's a permutation. Both are permutations of each other. Then we output yes. Otherwise, we output no. This is the solution for problem A. Let's move on to problem B. Okay, so Vasya has a grid with two rows and n columns. He colors each cell red, green or blue. Color blind and cannot distinguish green from blue. Determine if the two rows of the grid will be colored to be the same. So let's just look at it from Vasya's perspective. If he cannot distinguish green from blue, let's mark all of the cells which are green as blue and let's do it for both the rows. So I'm considering the first row to be string S, considering the second row to be string T. Now if both the strings are same, then S is equal to T, in which case you cannot distinguish between the two rows and they will be considered to be colored the same by Vasya. If S is equal to T, we output that yes, both the rows will look same, otherwise they will look different and we output no. I hope that solves it. It's just implementation about how Vasya sees. Let's move on to problem C. Word game. So this is also an implementation based problem. So three players play a game. They write down n distinct words of length 3. Then they total up the points. If the word was written by one person, he gets 3 points. Two people both get 1 point. And if the word was written by all, nobody gets any points. So how do we solve it? Let's go through all of the words written twice. First, let's go through it just for checking how many times a person has written it. And second time for assigning the points. So that's what I do. I write down all the strings in a vector of strings. Since there are three people, the outer size will be 3, and so it will be a 3 cross n matrix of strings. We read the string. This is just a read function. You can input all of the strings one by one, and then we store an integer for every string. So we find out how many times the particular string has been used, and we store this value in a map. So we go through all of the strings for all of the three players, all of their n strings, and increment the value in the map. And then finally, we want to give out points. Again, we go through all of the strings for all of the players. If we just find out that a particular string was only used by one of the player, we'll give him 3 points. If it was used by two players, then we'll give him 1 point. Otherwise, we'll give him 0 points. And thus, we find out the points for all of the three players and output it. And this is the vector function for printing vector, and thus we can like print the values for points of 0, points of 1 and points of 2. Okay, that should do it. Hopefully that is clear. Let's move on to problem D. Now there are n people standing in a line, each looking either to the left or to the right. Each person counts the number of people in the direction in which they are looking, and we want to make at most k changes, and we have value of k from 1 to n, and we make at most k changes such that the total number of people who are being looked at would be as high as possible. So let's try to understand something. Let's say we have n is equal to 5. That means we have 5 people. What would be the most ideal? What would be ideal? For the first two person, if they look at right, they can see, the first person can see 4 other people. For the second R, he can see 3 people. And let's say the last two are L, then they can see 4 and 3 people respectively. Now at the last position, if the person is looking to his left, he can see all the 4 previous positions. But if at the last position the person is looking to the right, he can see no one. He can see 0 positions. So what we can realize is that for the last n by 2 positions, looking at left is preferable, and for the first n by 2 positions, looking at right is preferable. What about the middle element? That we do not care about. It can either be L or R, and we'll be looking at the same number of people on both the side. So that's it. So what we want to do is try to optimize in such a way that the first half will contain R's and the second half will contain L's. But we only have a specific number of queries. We only have k changes that we can make. So whom should we prefer the most? Consider these two cases. Consider these two cases. Consider an L on the first position and consider an L on the second position. Just a second. Okay, so as I was saying, let's consider these two L's. So this person is currently looking at 0 people, but if I convert him from an L to an R, he will look at 4 more people. So we got a value change from 0 to 4. But if you consider this particular L, it's already looking at one person to its left, but if I change it to a right, it will be looking at 3 people. So it is always beneficial choosing extreme ends. So for L's, you should always try to change the first L, and for R's, you should always try to change the last R and start from there. So we should try to look at the extremes. If any of them needs changing, we will change them then and there. Otherwise, we'll try to move inward, inside and inside, and change whenever required. So that's how we should optimize. We should start from the ends and try to change them one by one, and finally reach towards the center. And at the middle position, if n is odd, at the middle position, we do not care whether our element is L or R. That's it. So let's see how we will implement that. So first, we want to calculate the actual answer. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to store my answers in a vector answer. So initial answer would be the current number of people that are being seen. So we can calculate that. If I'm looking towards my left, I'm at position I. So I can see people from position 0 to I minus 1, which are total of I people. So if I'm looking to the left and I'm at position I, I can see I people. But if I'm looking to my right, I can see from I plus 1 to n, so I can see n minus I plus 1 people. I can see from position I plus 1 to n minus 1, sorry. So I can see n minus 1 minus I plus 1 plus 1 people, that is n minus I minus 1 people. So now what we want to do, what I'll do is I'll start from the left side. So what I'll do is, let's say I have all of these values, I have 6 values. I'll start from this index, which is the first index from the left. And when I'm looking at the first index, I'll try to modify this guy as well as this guy. Try to modify the first guy as well as the last guy, whichever one can be modified. Then I'll move on to the second index and try to modify this guy, like the I is equal to 1 and I is equal to 4 position. And then I'll continue moving inward. I'll move inward step by step. And at each step, I will be looking at positions I as well as position of n minus I minus 1. These two positions I'm going to be looking at. So what I do is, if I has L, we obviously in the first half we want all of them to be R's, and in the second half we want all of them to be L's. So if in the first half I get an L, then I will convert it to an R and I will add whatever benefit I get. So how to calculate what benefit I get? So basically, I have my total answer, which is answer.back. That is the answer I have already gotten, and I will try to make changes. So by changing from an L to an R, let's see what we are getting extra. Just because that L has now been converted to an R, it can look at n minus I minus 1 positions. But we have already counted the people it was looking, the number of people that were being looked at when it was an L, which were I. So we need to subtract them because they are no longer being looked at. So we subtract I. So this is the total number of people that are being looked at now. Sum total of all the people that are being looked at now. Similarly, we look at this person, let's say the end last person, n minus 1, n minus 2, which is basically n minus I minus 1. And if it is looking towards its right, we want it to look towards its left. Thus, we will make the same computations. We will convert it to an L. And if we convert it to an L, the changes that we are going to get is, we are going to have our initial answer, which is answer.back. And here what is going to happen is, for a position j is equal to n minus I minus 1, if it was looking towards its left, it would see n minus I minus 1 people. and towards its right it would be looking at IPL, because j is equal to n minus I minus 1. Okay, so in general it would be I and n minus I minus 1 over here, but since our index is not I, our index itself is j. So if you just substitute j here, you will get n minus I minus 1, and if you substitute j inside here, you will get I. This is basically what our answer is. And since we were looking at our right before, we were getting I points, and we'll subtract those I points and we will add the current point, which is n minus I minus 1, which you are getting now, and push it to our answer. And sometimes what might happen is we already have a half sorted array, we already have L's and R's, so we might not need to use all operations. So if we don't need to use all operations, for the we are already at the max score. So for all the next values of k, you can just have the answer dot back, because that is already the most optimal answer, since all of the first half elements are already filled with L and all of the next half elements are already filled with R. So till our size becomes equal to n, we will push back the answer, and then we will output the answer 1 to answer n, because those are the points that we get after making 1 to n changes. After outputting all of this, this should be the correct answer. I hope this is kind of clear. Next we will move on to problem G, because it is a bit simpler than problem C and F. E and F have a bit more implementation to deal with. So let's look at problem G. So we want to find an array n of distinct non-negative integers less than 2 to the power 31. So 2 to the power 31 is quite large, it's about 10 to the power 9. Such that bitwise XOR of elements on odd indices equal to the bitwise XOR of elements on even indices. So let me just go into the way I did it. Okay. So let's consider cases where n is divisible by 4. So n is equal to some 4x, n is equal to some 4x plus 1, n is equal to some 4x plus 2, and n is equal to some 4x plus 3. Because in general, I have a solution that what I can keep doing is, the total number of entries I may have, the total number of indices in my array is only 2 into 10 to the power 5. That is like, so if I consider something like 2 raised to the power 20, which is an approximate, which is a value of greater than 10 to the power 6, I can keep using it without fearing that I will cross it. So for example, my strategy is, I have an element x, and then I have an element 2 raised to the power 20 plus x. So if I have 4 elements, x, y, let's say I have 4 elements, x, x plus 1, x plus 2, x plus 3, and I have x plus 2 raised to the power 20 plus 1, x plus 2 raised to the power 20 plus 2, and x plus 2 raised to the power 20 plus 3. If I consider all of them, I find out that the bitwise OR of these 4 indices will be same. I would have the same bitwise XOR for all of these indices, which would be just 0 or something, which would be just 0. So that's why I want to have these this 2 raised to the power 20 for even number of indices. So what I can do is, this is fine. So if n were just 4x, we could just have started with x, x plus 1, x plus 2, x plus 3, and had x plus 2 to 2 raised to the power 20, x plus 2 raised to the power 20 plus 1, x plus 2 raised to the power 20 plus 2, and x plus 2 raised to the power 20 plus 3, and had this, and these elements we will keep on odd indices, and these elements we will keep on even indices. Thus we can have the same bitwise XOR. But we may have odd elements or 4x plus 2 elements which I did not want to deal with, so I made some explicit cases for them. So if x is equal to 4x plus 1, we can simply add 0, because 0 does not change the bitwise XOR. So let's just add 0 at the start and use the same technique that we used here. Okay, this is what I do. I just find out how many numbers I need. So for each value I can have x and 2 raised to the power 20 plus x. I find out how many numbers I need. So what I'm going to be doing is, this 1, 2 and 3 I'll take care of by myself, and remaining 4x we can deal with later. Remaining 4x can be dealt with later. So we need some numbers to satisfy this one. So if I just put a 0 at the start, it does not change the bitwise XOR in any way, and then I can just append all of the elements corresponding to 4x. Okay, so the number of elements required here would be like, number of pairs required here would be n by 4 into 2. Similarly, number of pairs required here would be n by 4 into 2 of such pairs, x and x plus 2 raised to the power 20, and we are just adding one extra element 0, so that like the number of elements is consistent. And since 0 does not change any bitwise XOR, we would not have any troubles here. Now let's consider n is equal to 4x plus 3, If that is so, we could just add numbers 1, 2 and 3. Since the XOR of 1 and 3, 1 XOR 3 is equal to 2, this would not have any effect on the overall array. And if you just use the same process and just append 1, 2, 3 to it, it will still work. That's what we are going to do in this case. Now, n is equal to 4x plus 2 case. In this case, I require just like two numbers, but if those two numbers are distinct, they will never have the same XOR. And also n is greater than 3. So for n is equal to 4x plus 2 case, I just considered it to be 4x plus 6 case. I just considered 6 elements which have XOR of 0. So those 6 elements, you can choose anything, just anything. You can just randomly choose anything you want. What I chose was 9, 5, 12, 1, 2, 3. This is because XOR of 1 and 3 is 2 and XOR of 9 and 12 is 5. So the XOR of 9, 12 and 2 would be XOR of 5, 1 and 3. So again, you get a same XOR in this subarray of 6 elements, and later you can just use the same procedure to have our remaining 4x elements. That is the process I was using for this problem. And once we do that, we need to find the number of pairs. So since the total number of elements required is n, for almost all cases, what we are going to do is we have n by 4 elements. So floor of n by 4 elements that we need to have. So floor of n by 4 times 4 elements, which is basically floor of n by 4 times 2 pairs that are required. Pairs of x and 2 raised to the power 20 plus x. This is what we are looking at. But in one case, I took liberty that instead of 4x plus 2, I used 4x plus 6. So in this case, what I'm going to do is say that my required number of pairs is minus 2. So then let's just consider the implementation I wrote for that. So this is the number of pairs that I have required. This is my answer vector. So if we have just one, if n mod 4 is just 1, we just add 0, as I said earlier. If n mod 4 is 2, then I add 9, 5, 12, 1, 2, 3. But I have also taken two extra pairs. So for these two extra pairs, I do required minus equals 2. And if n mod 4 is equal to 3, I add 1, 2, 3. And now for each, so while for all the required pairs, what I do is I add x and 2 raised to the power 20 plus x. So I have just predefined them. So basically st is 13. Since I already used elements till 12, I have started with 13. So st is starting, it starts from 13. And then I add 2 raised to the power 20 and just keep on adding elements here and print it out to a vector. So this is the solution for problem G. I hope it was okay, it was understandable. And we'll move on to problem E and F now, which are kind of more complicated. Okay. So you have n rectangles, the ith rectangle is height hi and width wi, and I have queries for hs, ws, hb, wv, and I want to find out the area of sum of area of rectangles which can fit a rectangle of hs and width ws, but also themselves fit in hb and wv. So mathematically, simply they have given the relation. This is the only relation we need to care about. So in general, it is pretty complicated because for each query we have 4 variables and we also have to find out which one fits into what. So in general, it might be kind of confusing. So when I read this problem, I felt this was a bit tricky and I didn't know what to do. But then we look at the constraints. The constraints is that h of I and w of I is just 1000. It's just 1000. That gives us an idea of what we might possibly do for the problem. So what we can do is for each query, since we have 10 to the power 5 queries and we have a very good time limit of 6 seconds, we can move through all of the HS for every particular query. That would just be like 10 to the power 8 operations, which is fine, which can easily be done in 6 seconds because 6 seconds is a lot of time. Okay, so what we can do is, if we somehow manage to just iterate over all of the heights for each particular query, then we can find out the weights by doing some kind of binary search. Okay, so let's have a look. For example, what I did was I would have a vector consisting of all of the heights. So I have height was equal to 1, height is equal to 2, height is equal to 3. This contains all of my boxes that I have, and height is equal to 1000 because this is the maximum height that you can have. Now for each corresponding height, I will write whatever widths I have possible, whatever widths I have allowed. Let's say here I have width 3, 5, 7, 9. Here I have 2, 4, 6. Here I have 7, 10. Here I have 15, 20, 25, something like this. I'll just make a vector for each height. So I made a bunch of vectors. I made 1001 vectors, and each vector will consist of all the widths that are particular for the possible for that particular height. So what I'm trying to do is, this is just a small optimization. So what I did was, if I do not use the whole length from 1 to 1000, if I just use like all of my hits are between 200 to 500, I will just consider iterating between 200 to 500. That's what I'm doing. I'm just calculating smallest height and biggest height. This is just for implementation purpose, but that's not important. So in general, what I'm trying to do is, I just first clear all of the vectors and initialize with 0. I initialize with 0 because later I'm going to use like lower bound and upper bound, and I do not want to get stuck at begin and don't want to have any problems there. So I just added a rectangle of height, I just inserted a height of 0, which will like never, not really be used. Okay, so what we are doing is, for each of the n element, for all of the n rectangles that I have, I will store at h of, so let's say the height is hh and width is ww. So for h of hh, I will store the value ww, as I mentioned here. So for example, if I get a pair 1, 3, in for h is equal to 1, I will store another value, which is 3. Here. This is the strategy that we are going to use. So, and then we are going to sort all of the vectors, because for each height we want to do binary search in the vector from. So if you want to do binary search in the vector, we have to sort the vector. So my overall idea is, which all rectangles will be good for me. That is what I want. Okay. So let's say my query is such that my smallest height possible would be, I'll write smallest height possible is 1, and the largest height possible for me is equal to 4. Let's say that is the case. So the smallest rectangle, that my inner rectangle was 1 height and the outer rectangle was of height 4, and inner width was of height, let's say 5, and outer rectangle was of width, let's say 8. So what I want to do is, I will iterate through these values. I will go through height, I will go from height 2 to height 3. So basically, I will go from height smallest height plus 1 to height largest height minus 1, since these are the allowed heights that I have. So on iterating through all of these heights, we have all of the corresponding widths that we have, and then we will binary search to find out what is the smallest width we can have and what is the largest width we can have. Okay, and those possible combinations are our good combinations. So for example, height is equal to 2. In this case, my minimum width was 5, so this is not correct. I can just have like 6 here. So height is equal to 2, width is equal to 6 is a good combination for us. Similarly, height is equal to 3, width is equal to 7 is a good combination for us here. But we just don't need to find a number of good combinations. If you would have needed to find a number of good combinations, we could have just did the same procedure, and then we, using a lower bound and upper bound, we could have found the number of indices lying between small h big h and small w big w. But we also need to find out the area. So finding out the area is a more complicated part, because we would also need to multiply all of these h's with all of these w's. So for that, what I do is, I maintain this, but I also maintain another array of vectors, in which instead of storing 3, 5, 7, 9, I will store their prefix sum. So instead of 3, 5, 7, 9, I will store 3, 8, 15, 24. So this is because, what I want to do is basically h times w. So h I already know, so I want to do h of w, w, let's say I go from wx to wy. So I want to do h into wx plus wx plus 1 plus so on till wy. But this can also be written as h of wy, sorry, prefix value till wy minus prefix value till wx minus 1. That's it. H of prefix value till y minus prefix value till x minus 1. If you do that, you do not need to linearly search through all of the widths and then like calculate the area for each rectangle. You can just use prefix sums to calculate this area. So this is the strategy that we are using. So what we are doing is, we are maintaining the vector of heights, array of vectors of height, but we are also maintaining the prefix sum of these heights. So h is the normal array of vectors, but h2 is the prefix sum version of it. So what I'm going to do is, first I calculate all of this h, then I sort all of these vectors, and then as I move through all of these vectors, I calculate the prefix sums. So if it's the first element, its value is just h of I of j, otherwise it is h of I of j plus h2 of I of j minus 1. That is how I calculate the prefix sum of these values. And this is what we will be using later. So So the exact procedure I used is what we are going to be using. For each query, we look at HS, WS, HB, WB. Now what I want to do, this is just an optimization that I told you earlier. So if I'm not using all from 0 to 1000, if I'm just using heights from 100 to 200, what I'm doing is I'm just like, if I'm using heights from 100 to 200, but my given box has a maximum height of 1000, I don't need to go to 1000. I can just go till 200 and 1 and then stop, because it's not needed. So that's what I'm doing. So I thought if I were on the verge of like time limit exceeded or something, I can just minimize using this. This is not really important. I think even if I remove that, my solution would be good enough. Okay, then I move from HS plus 1 to HB. So basically my in my template, the final index is not counted. So basically I'm going from HS plus 1 to HB minus 1. In it, what I do is I find out upper bound in H of I for WS. So once I find out the upper bound, I know which is the first element which has a value of width at least WS plus 1. That's what upper bound gives me. And lower bound gives me the first element which has a width of WB. So what I want to do is, I don't want any element of width WB, and I want all elements with width greater than WS, which is like starting from WS plus 1. So if I think about it, if my x is x itself is like hi dot size, x itself is the larger than the last element, then I continue, because I know that all of the rectangles that I have which need to be fit inside this query, all are larger than or equal to the query itself. So I just continue. I know I'm not going to get any answer here. But if y is equal to int of hi dot size, that means that the outer rectangle, the largest rectangle that I have, those can have all of the rectangles. If y is equal to hi dot size, that means that the rectangle that I have, that is given in the query, is larger than all of the rectangles that I have height wise. For this particular height, all of the widths of the rectangles that I have are smaller than my width of my query. So in it, I can take all of the elements I have. So I can start from h2 of I dot back and subtract h2 of I of x minus 1. Because h2 of I of x minus 1 represents the prefix sum of all elements with height I, but width less than x. Okay, so this is the prefix sums that I told, and this is the prefix sum of the width, and we will multiply it with the height, and the height is I. This will give us the sum of areas for height I, which are good, which satisfy the following conditions. Otherwise, if it's not the last element, we know that we cannot take this element also, because it is the first element where my width is WB, where my width is WB. So I take the sum of all elements till y minus 1 and subtract all of the sum of all elements till x minus 1. This will give me the prefix sum of all the elements with height I, which fit in the given width, and then I multiply it with the height I to get the total area. So this is the prefix sum of the width multiplied by the height to give you the area. And this is basically all the answer for this particular height. And thus we will integrate this, we will sum this answer from all heights HS plus 1 to HB minus 1 to give us our total answer, which I'm storing in the variable temp, and finally I will output the variable temp. So you have to do this for every query. I hope this is kind of clear. The important concept here was to first understand that the constraints on H were very small. So for you could iterate through all of the heights, just checking for the widths. And once you know what is the height, you also know what range of widths you need to be over and under. So that you can find using lower bound and upper bound. And you also want to find out the areas. So if you want to find out the areas, you need to find out the prefix, like the sum of all the widths in your correct range times height. So for the sum of all the widths in the given range, you can use prefix sums to calculate sum of widths, which I have used in H2. This is the complete solution to the problem. It's kind of tricky. I hope it's understandable. Let's move on to the final problem, which is F. So in F, what you need to understand is that all of your stars should be in some kind of an L shape, and these L shapes should not be touching at any corner, should not be touching at any edge. So the way I solved this problem, I think that was a simple enough approach to understand. We will look at both of these conditions. Okay. That's so. Let us assume let me consider a very big square. Okay. Let me consider a 5x5 square. Okay, I just had one more column. Okay, let us consider this to be my grid, and let me consider. What I am doing in my problem is the solution. My solution involves going through all 2x2 subarrays. So first I'll go through this subarray, then I will go through this subarray, then I will go through this subarray. I will go through all of the subarrays, and for each subarray I will check according to its characteristics. So what I'm going to check in a subarray is whether it contains an L shape. That's the only thing I'm going to be checking in a subarray. So how to check that? That's pretty simple. If the particular 2x2 subarray contains 3 filled elements, it is an L shape. Consider any possible orientation. Consider this, it's an L shape. Consider this is an L shape. Okay, then also you might have this as an L shape and this as an L shape. There are 4 L shapes. So a particular 2x2 subarray, if it contains any 3 elements filled, it is an L shape. So this is the first satisfied criteria. So my solution that I am proposing is that we go through all of these subarrays, we see if there is an L shape in that subarray. If there is an L shape in a subarray, I'll just remove that L shape. And what I'll do is I'll remove L shapes from all the 2x2 subarrays, and if at the end I can find some single element or some 2 elements joined together, then my answer is no, because those were not part of any L shape. Now this is the first condition. This is the first condition that we had to look at in the problem, that each shaded cell is a part of exactly one L shape. So we are looking at a subarray. Okay, now exactly one L shape. For that, I am considering that if in a particular subarray I have all 4 elements filled, that means there are multiple L shapes dealing with that element and we don't want them at all. That is why if any particular subarray consists of 4 elements, our answer should automatically be no, because it automatically contains more than one L shape, which is like joined together, which is this one and this one. So we won't allow that. And now we don't want any L shapes to be attached by edge or corner. So how do we deal with it? For this, I will draw some L shape. Okay. I will go to the board. Okay. So let's say I have an L shape here. This is my L shape. So if I have an element here, or here, or here, or here, or here, or here, 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 here. Any element in all of these positions. Am I missing one more element? No, this is... No, okay, also this one, yeah. Okay, all of these elements, if any of those are filled, then it's automatically gone. Because if I have an element here, whether it's a part of an L shape or not a part of an L shape, it is going to be touching. If it's not a part of an L shape, it's automatically wrong. If it's part of an L shape, it is touching this point. So all of these points are touching some points here or there, either by corner or either by edge. So all of the elements, there should be no one, if we consider a particular L shape. Now one interesting thing over here is that it contains all of these elements in this 3x3 grid. It contains all of these elements in this 3x3 grid, except our smaller grid. We are not considering that because you are automatically taking care of that before itself. Except for one element. Except for this element here, right here. So what tells which element is the one which does not matter? For example, this element could have had an L shape like this and we would not have cared, because it would not have crossed us. So how does it, which elements are, which is those? So for, if we have an L shape like this, okay, then this element is safe. If we have an L shape like this, this element is safe. If we have an element L shape like this, this element is safe. And what is the final L shape? Like this. Okay. Like this, then this element is safe. So we have a whole triangle of 4x4. So all of these outer elements have to be empty except for the one which is directly opposite to the square, which is not filled in the smaller subarray. I hope this is clear. This is the element which is free. Even if it has one or not, does not have one, we don't care. But all of the other elements here should be empty. Otherwise, it is going to be no. So that is what we are planning. So first of all, what I do, I store all of these values in a grid. Then what I do is, one interesting implementation detail that you may want to consider is that in general, if you just consider N and M, you need to do a lot of casework. You need to consider if I'm in my first row or in my last row. And if you're in your first row, you cannot use like J plus 2 or something, J plus J minus 1 or something. Because it is not stored in memory because our array does not have that index. You will give negative indices or indices out of frames. So generally what I do is I just give more indices. So I just have a vector which is of size n by 4 times m by 4. This is because I don't want to deal with issues with plus 2, minus 2. I just have those as empty because it doesn't matter. Like if I just consider them even as empty, it won't matter to me because it is always 0. It will give me just give me 0. So that's why I chose a larger array, larger vector of vector size. So I do not need to care about all of these elements. Okay. Just a second. Sorry for the issue. I hope it's visible. Yeah. So what I'm doing is, if my subarray contains two or lesser elements, I don't care. Like it's not going to be a part of any L shape, and we do not need to deal with it. If it has four elements in a subarray, we just output no because it already has two L shapes within the same subarray, which is not allowed. Now the only case which is left is if I have a size of 3. Now if I have a size of 3, I need to find out the sum of all of these elements. Which elements? Let me reiterate. So what I'm going to find sum of all of these elements, like in the outer perimeter, except for the one element. Except for one element which we have discussed earlier. Okay? So how can we compute it? Basically, this is for each subarray, I'm marking it by its left and up cell. So this subarray, this particular subarray is represented by I, j, where I and j is the index, row and column of the first element here. So all the elements in this row are row I minus 1 and go from column j minus 1 to j plus 2. Okay. Similarly, all the elements in the bottom corner are in row I plus 2 and go from index j minus 1 to j plus 2. Okay. So I just summed them up. Index from I minus 1 and k goes from j minus 1 to j plus 2. Similarly, row I plus 1 and k goes from j minus 1 to j plus 2. I summed all of these elements and now I want to include these two elements, these four elements, which I did not include earlier. Okay, the colors are bit similar. So these four elements, which I have marked with black red. Okay. So we can do them individually. They are I, j minus 1, I plus 1, j minus 1, I, j plus 2, and I plus 1, j plus 2. We add all of these elements. Now we know that this contains an extra element. For example, we know that this contains these elements also, which I told you earlier were fine. We did not care about them. But in our sum, those elements are also there. So my the sum total of val here might be 1, but my answer might still be correct. Because I did not consider this element yet. So I need to find out what type of L shape it is, and depending on that, exclude this element specifically. That's what I'm going to be doing now. So for example, if grid I, j is 0, that means my L shape is this one. I hope it's visible, because this element is 0 and other three are 1. So in this case, I will remove this element. Even if its value is 1, I will subtract the value of this element. So what I do is, from val I subtract grid of I minus 1 comma j minus 1, and if still the value of val is not equal to 0, that means that some other of the 8 elements has value of 1, which is unacceptable, and we will just return no. Similarly, if grid of I comma j plus 1 is 0, that means that that means that we can have grid of I minus 1 or j plus 2. That can be 1, we do not care about that. So we'll subtract the value of that. And if it's still if val is still not equal to 0, we again output no. Similarly, you can do the same for the other two cases. Just subtract the appropriate element. And now, if our algorithm is still running, that means that we found up a proper L shape and it is fine. Now, if we found a proper L shape, we have to remove that L shape. So to remove that L shape, just make the whole subarray 0, because you took all of the L shapes that the subarray could provide, and also there were no conflicts, there were no issues because of this subarray. So we'll just remove the existence of this subarray. Now once we run all this for all of the particular cells, all of the subarrays of size 2 by 2, we will be removing all of the LCFS possible. So now if there is any more element left in this whole grid, that means that it was a single element or a double element, which is not allowed because it was not a part of any LCF. Thus we still output no. If all of this works out, finally we output yes. This is the whole solution for the problem. It is a bit complicated, like it involves a bit of thinking detail, but once we get the thinking detail down, it is pretty doable. Okay, so this was the solution to all of the problems. I hope all of these pass. At least I do not see any issue with them. If you have any doubts, please feel free to ask. Thanks for watching the video.